Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our East Beach Church family worship, our all-age worship service that we're having during this period. We're doing all-age services every Sunday morning, and then we do a more ordinary type service in our evening at 7 p.m. tonight. Tonight's going to be communion. I mentioned that now so that our guys can be ready. We're trying to still share around the communion table during lockdown. We do that by having bread and a cup of dark juice, grape juice if you've got it, but a dark juice or squash. And we each take it individually in our homes, but together. And so we'll be doing that tonight as part of our service. This morning, we're continuing to celebrate VE Day, which was Friday, of course, on Friday, the 8th of May. 75 years ago, the end of the war was announced by Winston Churchill. You probably watched lots of stuff on television that is going over those times and looking at the celebrations that were happening all over the country. And we're going to be reflecting on that a bit this morning. The King gave messages, and of course, the Queen has given a message to us just on that day as well, this on Friday. So the celebrations are carrying on today. I'm sure you'll be able to find things that are going on TV and maybe even in your street still. But we're going to celebrate VE Day, but also connect it with an incredible victory that we celebrate. VE stands, of course, for Victory in Europe. And in 1945, the announcement of the end of World War II came, didn't it? But we have an incredible victory that we celebrate all the while as Christians, and we're going to connect that in today. We're also going to be thinking of connecting it with a victory that we're longing for, the victory over the coronavirus. So we'll be thinking about those things. But I thought it'd be great to start with prayer and then with a great hymn of victory. So let's pray, shall we, as we begin our worship together. Father, we thank you that we can join together through YouTube, through the internet, and worship you, even though we can't physically go to our building. We're missing it. We're longing to get back there, but we're thankful that we can still connect together in this wonderful way. We thank you that across the country, churches are meeting today to celebrate the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we thank you that too, as a nation, we're celebrating that you brought this country through to freedom and victory those 75 years ago. We pray that as we worship and celebrate this morning, you'll help us to give you the glory and honor you deserve. Help us to give you the thanks that we ought to have in our hearts for all of these things. But also we pray that you'll bless us and encourage and strengthen our hearts for the battles we still face, particularly the current battle against the coronavirus that is waging war across this whole globe, not just locally. We pray then in Jesus' name that you'll bless us and that you'll help us to worship and glorify your name in this hour we spend together. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I wonder if some of you miss that great old organ sound that we used to have. Well, we've got a treat for you today. Fran is going to lead us in our first hymn, and she's going to lead us using the hymn. You might need to put the volume up a bit. Oh. Here we go. Takes a little while to get the music synced.
Is it playing? Mm. 1 second. I did double click.
Risen, conquering Son, endless is the victory thou wilt get has won. Angels in bright raiment brought the stone away. Let the folded grave cross where thy body lay. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory our Lord death has won. Lord Jesus, meet us, risen from the tomb. Lovingly he greets us, scattered sand and gloom. Let the church with gladness hymns of triumph sing. For her Lord now liveth, death has lost his sting. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won. Long will we doubt thee, glorious Prince of Life. Life is not without thee, aid us in our strife. Make us more than conquerors through thy deathless love. Bring us in thy triumph to thy home above. Thine be the glory, risen conquering Son. Endless is the victory thou, O death, hast won.
Wow, that was glorious, wasn't it? We do miss the organ being played. We had a wonderful organ player. He's not been well. Mike, our hearts go out to you and Maureen. And we've not been able to have that sound for quite a while. So it's lovely to actually be able to reproduce it using these modern electronic keyboards. Thank you, Fran. Well, we are looking then at VE Day, which was all about celebrating the 75th anniversary, and there were sort of various ideas and means and ways that we were going to celebrate that, and we put together a few pictures of how our guys celebrated.
Meet again, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So will you please say hello to the folks that I know, tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We meet again, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
We'll meet again, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So
I'm sure you had other pictures and things that you got up to. I just used there the pictures that got to me through WhatsApp and were emailed to me, and just put them together. We used it last night, actually, at our family fun evening. And just to give you a taste of our family fun evenings, we were doing memory quiz. And our memory quiz on, we watched that video. I should have prepared you, really. We watched that video, and then I gave 8 questions which are based upon that video. I wonder how you will get on with them. We're going to go through them quite quickly. So just for a little bit of fun, how will you get on? Let's see. Okay, how long was that video? Do you think it was 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, or 4 minutes? Okay, make your choice. And the answer is 3 minutes. So you can keep a tally. It's going to be out of 8. The second one is, how many photos showed the church building? There were several photos of the church building. Was it 2, 3, 4, or 5? Make your choice. Okay, the answer is 3. Yep, there were 3. Let's go on to the, there they are. They were the 3 pictures of the church building. Next question. What shape were made? Were used to make the cardboard dome that Ellie and Harry made. What shapes did they use? Was it triangles, squares, pentagons, or hexagons? And if you don't know what pentagons or hexagons are, don't worry.
5 and 6-sided.
5 and 6-sided, yeah. Okay, it was, of course, triangles. I thought this was absolutely incredible design. Next picture, yeah, there it is. Marvellous. I like that. Next, there was a fresh fruit covered cake in there. Melanie made it. Which fruits were used on top of that cake? Strawberries and raspberries, strawberries and blueberries, raspberries and blueberries, or strawberries and blackberries? Well, I'm sure you were observing, weren't you, that it was raspberries and blueberries. There they are. Cool, close up, that looks really scrumptious. This is the hardest one, I think, because it was difficult just looking at the picture for a few seconds to count them up. How many toys were attending the teddy bear's picnic in the picture? Was it 3, 6, 9, or 12? Anyone who came last night, of course, knows the answers. But if you didn't watch last night, bit of jeopardy there. It's number 9 toys. There were 2 on this chair, 2 on that chair, and 2 in that chair. So, oh, that's not a chair, it's a wheelbarrow, isn't it? Yeah, so there were 9 altogether. What musical instrument appeared in one of the photos? Were you observant? Bagpipes, a recorder, was it a drum, or the guitar? It was, of course, my guitar. I didn't actually play it in the end because we were listening to some music on the CD rather than playing. Which flags, other than Union flags, that's the Union Jack type thing, we call them Union flag. Which flags other than those, though, appeared in the picture? Was there a flag of Canada, the Canada flag, or the England flag? Was it the United States? Was it the Canada flag on its own? Or was it a Canada flag and a United States flag? This was a difficult one as well. It was, of course, Canada and England. And here's the 2 photos. There's the Canada flag there that was a part of the bunting. And then this guy's got the England flag hanging out of his, that's Peter, that is Peter and Yvonne. So what, last question then, what unusual item were on the table in front of the puppets in the puppet picture? It was at the beginning and the end, so you had two chances to see this one. Was it a bubble machine, some medals, a straw boater, or some cuddly toys? It was, of course, some medals that belonged to Lynn's dad. Here they are. One, two, there's four there. A couple of stars and the medals. Don't you love that puppet picture? It's one of my favourites, actually, of the VE Day. He looks so happy, doesn't he? He looks like he's really celebrating with his flag and his mouth open. Hallelujah. Well, I hope you have just enjoyed that. A little bit of a taster of what we got up to in the VE Day celebrations. But what I want us to think about what we celebrate as Christians today. What do we celebrate? What is the victory that Christians celebrate all the time? And I thought about this last week, so I'm not going to take a lot of time on it because I was thinking about this last week. But I just wanted to remind you of the verse we looked at last week. Lindy?
Yep.
The verse we looked at last week was one of the verses we looked at was Colossians 2:15. And we were thinking about how the victory we celebrate is a victory that Christ won for us on the cross. He disarmed the powers and authorities, his enemies. That doesn't mean earthly powers and authorities. He's speaking of spiritual powers, Satan and his dominions. After disarming the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. That's Colossians 2:15. This was the triumph we celebrate. The victory we celebrate is the victory of Jesus Christ. And we talked about that last week. But what we're going to talk about today is why do we celebrate? Why do we celebrate? So we'll look at that in a minute. But first of all, we're going to actually do a bit of celebrating. We're going to sing Jesus, we celebrate your victory.
Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. To the yoke of slavery. So we're rejoicing in God's victory, our hearts responding to his love. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Jesus, we revel in your love. His spirit in us releases us from fear. The way to him is open, with boldness we draw near. And in his presence, our problems disappear. Our hearts responding to his love. Jesus, we celebrate your victory. Us, we revel in your love, Jesus. We rejoice, you set us free, Jesus. Your death has brought us life.
I meant to say this morning, children, that it'd be great to be waving your flags at some of these. We were singing in the week, flag is a joy is a flag flying high from the castle of my heart. Do you know that one? Went like this. Joy is a flag flying high from the castle of my heart, from the castle of my heart, from the castle of my heart. Joy is a flag flying high from the castle of my heart, for the king is in residence there. So let it fly in the sky, let the whole world know, let the whole world know, let the whole world know. So let it fly in the sky, let the whole world know that the king is in residence there. So it's a good flag flying song, but if you want to wave your flag to some of the songs that we're singing this morning, please do. Well, we're going to start looking at why we celebrate. Why do we celebrate? Well, why are we celebrating VE Day? We're celebrating VE Day because it brought peace, an end to the war, an end to the conflict, an end to the fighting. We're not celebrating the killing, we're celebrating the end of all those things and the fact that it brought about peace. And of course, this is why we celebrate Christ's victory, because on the cross it says he conquered the enemy, he conquered sin. Sin was the problem we had between us and God. Sin was the reason we were, the Bible says, enemies with God. And it was a terrible place to be, enemies with God. We don't want to be enemies with God. The God who made us, the God who loves us, the God who created this world. The Bible says because of our sin, no, that's what we are. And that's what we were. But when we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, he gives us peace. There's this lovely verse from Isaiah 53, verse 5. Would you read it, Lindy, please? Can you read it from there?
He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Isaiah 53, verse 5.
And Isaiah 53 is a lovely passage that talks about Christ, really, although it's written long years before Jesus. And it says one of the things that happened on the cross is that our sins were taken by Christ on the cross. Remember, I talked about that a while ago. And as a result, we can be at peace with him. By at peace, it means that we're reconciled. What happened when the way the war ended between us and Germany is that the leaders of both sides sat down and they wrote an agreement that brought peace. And so the two sides were reconciled. It's been lovely over the years is that now there is a reconciliation. The whole of Europe, including Germany, are all at peace with one another. Because of that, what happened 75 years ago, and the Bible says because of what Christ did, we can be at peace with God. We can be at peace with God. The war between us and God can be over. I think there's another verse after this one.
Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 5, verse 1.
Romans 5 is another lovely passage. If you want to read some more, Isaiah 53, Romans 5, read some more of it. But it begins with this lovely verse that we have peace with God. When we put our trust in Jesus, justified means made to be just as if we'd never sinned. God, remember, he takes our sin and put it on Christ on the cross, and he took his righteousness and put it on me. And now, instead of being an enemy of God because of my sin, I'm a friend of God because he sees in me the righteousness of Jesus. And so I'm at peace with God. He's not angry with me anymore. I'm at peace. And I think there's just one more verse.
Romans 5, verse 10. While we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son.
And all these verses are emphasizing this same idea. Reconciled means brought back into friendship. When we get reconciled with someone, it means instead of being enemies, we're back into friendship with them. And we came back into friendship with God. Even while we were enemies, God, Christ died for us. And then we were reconciled to him through how? Through Jesus' death. So now we're friends with God again because of what Jesus did for us. And so we can be at peace. Now I think of, at the moment, there's still a battle raging, isn't there, with this coronavirus. And people are not at peace in this world. We're anxious, we're troubled, we're worried. And until we have the victory over that virus, until that vaccine is found, and we feel that we've conquered this virus, we're not going to be at peace. We're going to be troubled. We're going to be worried. We're going to wonder what the future is going to hold, whether we're going to catch it, what's going to happen to our livelihood financially. But all these things are worrying us. What's going to happen to our loved ones? We have all these. We're not at peace, are we? When we found that vaccine, and we will be restored to peace over that issue. But you can know God's peace in your life now by putting your trust in Jesus. Do you know God's peace in your life? I hope you do. If not, listen in, and I hope that you'll understand that you can know the peace of God and rightness with God through Jesus. We're going to sing a song that mentions how what Jesus did on the cross links us to the peace of God. Verse 2 particularly talks about the peace of God. This is a new song we've been learning, which we're loving, called Amazing Love. That last line leads us into our second point, offering life to all who accept it. So we're looking at the reasons why we celebrate the victory of Christ. Why do we celebrate Christ's victory? The second one then is this. Because Christ conquered death. His victory was to conquer death so that we could have life. We have life. Why do they celebrate VE Day? Not because of the death, but because of the life that has been preserved. Look, we do appreciate the sacrifice that was made to bring us that life, don't we? And we appreciate the sacrifice of Christ. His death brought us life. And so the death of many brought life to this country, the hope of life, and many more lives were preserved. We sadly do remember the men who died, but many more were preserved because of the victory. We're going to look at a couple of verses that remind us that that is what Christ's death was all about.
This is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. 1 John 5, verse 11.
Oh, if only people understood that the gospel, the good news about Jesus, is about life. He came that we might have life and have it to the full, it says somewhere else. God isn't about taking away life, but giving life. But giving not just life, but eternal life. We'll think about that in the next point. But God wants us to enjoy life. And of course, the best known verse in the Bible reminds us of this too.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16.
God wants us to not die, but have life. God wants us to put our trust in Jesus so that we live and don't die. Life is in his Son, it says somewhere else. Life is in Jesus, the only true life and lasting life and wonderful life and eternal life is in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we look at VE Day and we saw how it brought life to this country again. And people no longer lived in the fear of death, certainly not through war. There were still other hassles, of course, of life and the ordinary troubles and trials of life that bring death. But the death that came through the war had been put an end to through the victory that was gained. And of course, we're living again in the throes of an enemy that is taking life. When we think of the coronavirus and how it's taking life, why do we want to conquer this coronavirus? Because we want life, not death. And so we're praying, aren't we, for the scientists? We're praying for the medical staff who are preserving life of those who've got it. We're praying for the scientists who are trying to create a vaccine that will stop anyone getting it and dying from it. Why are we doing that? Because life is important. We want people to live and not die. And Jesus died on the cross. God so loved this world that he wasn't willing to let us die and perish without him in our sin. He wanted us to live. And he's given us eternal life through his Son. What have we got to do? Whoever believes. That song ended says, to those who accept him, he gives life. To those who believe, he gives life. Oh, put your trust. Do you have eternal life? If your answer to that is, I hope so, then you need to sort things out. Because the Bible says we can know that we have eternal life. We can know him. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. Put your trust in Jesus and don't leave it to hope. Leave it to confident assurance. Brilliant. There's another verse, I think.
John 17, verse 3. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent.
So eternal life isn't about trying to do good and win God's approval. It's about accepting his son, Jesus. It's about knowing who God is. It's about knowing who Jesus is. It's about knowing what he's done for you. And it's about knowing that he will keep his promise that if you put your trust in him, he will give you eternal life. That's why we celebrate the victory of Jesus. We're going to do that again. I've got another great celebration song that says, why do we celebrate? We celebrate the one who loved us and gave us life. And it goes like this.
Come on and celebrate his gift of love. We will celebrate the Son of God who loved us and gave us life. We'll shout your praise, O King. You give us joy, nothing else to bring.
Are you celebrating? I hope you're celebrating this morning. Not just celebrating VE Day. Great to celebrate that. But celebrating the fact that we've got a victorious Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, too. Okay. Well, here's our third reason for celebrating. It's already been hinted at, really, in that last one. When the enemy has been dealt with, when life is assured, hope is restored. A hope for a future. During the war, when things were at their darkest, it was difficult to hang on to hope. And when we were in our sin, what hope did we have for the future? We didn't know what would happen. I remember growing up as a boy and thinking, what's going to happen to me when I die? Am I ready to die? I wasn't confident. I wasn't sure. I knew I wasn't a good lad. And I was quite a bad lad. Well, we all are. The Bible says we all are sinners. We've all sinned and fallen short of God's glory. And so what hope did we have of trying to impress God? Our only hope was to make up a God who would accept us the way we were. And this is what people tend to do. I think God will accept me because I think I might have just done a few more good deeds than bad deeds. And we make up a God in our mind who's going to accept us despite our weaknesses. Well, God's not like that. We've all fallen short. We're all in trouble. We We haven't got any hope. But what Jesus did, why do we celebrate his victory? We celebrate because he conquered hell and gave us hope. See, the Bible says when Jesus died on the cross, he conquered sin and death, and he came back and rose again to life to show he conquered death. And it says he's got the keys and the gates of hell. That means he has the keys to unlock hell and deliver us from it. That was in that verse, really, John 3:16. When it says shall not perish, it doesn't mean die, ordinary die. It means live forever without God, in an eternal state of being away from the blessings and goodness of God. So instead of eternal life, we have basically an eternal death. And Jesus conquered hell so that we could be rescued from that destiny and brought into a happier destiny, the destiny of an eternal life with God. And that gives us hope. As soon as we put our trust in Christ, as soon as that war was over, everyone started to celebrate. Why? Because no more death. The enemy, the victory had been won. There was no more death. There was suddenly peace. There was suddenly life, and there was suddenly hope to rebuild a future. And when Jesus comes into your life, he does that. He deals with the sin, which gives you peace with God. He gives you eternal life, which gives you joy and happiness. But he also restores this hope for the future, not just hope for this life. Yes, we have hope for this life because we now have God on our side. We now have a friend who sticks closer than a brother. We now have a good shepherd who looks after his sheep. But we also have an eternal destiny, a glorious eternal destiny with God. Life forever. Let's look at a verse.
The last enemy to be destroyed is death. 1 Corinthians 15:26.
Another wonderful chapter for you to read later. 1 Corinthians 15. We've looked at it already, so I'm not going to go through it, but it's all about hope in the resurrection. We have a hope that God is going to destroy our final enemy of death. It's not been destroyed yet, has it? People are still dying. Death ended at the end of the war, from the war, but it carried on. The coronavirus, you know, death is still happening. But when we've conquered that vaccine, then we'll start to bring an end to death. It won't happen all at once. Did you know that? The vaccine will go out, and as the vaccine goes out, less and less deaths. But the virus will completely conquered when we've all been vaccinated against it and are far less likely to get it. And you know, the same is true. Jesus on the cross conquered death. Death was beaten. But you know, it's still having an impact on the world for a while. But one day, death itself will be destroyed. That's what 1 Corinthians 15 is talking about. When Jesus returns to this world, death itself will be destroyed. It will be the, you know, that was a great, called the Great War. It wasn't great good. It was a big, great, big war. And many people died. And people thought that might be the end of war. But it's not been, has it? There's wars and rumours of war all the world, over the world at the moment. Thankfully, we've not had another world war. But one day there will be a complete end to all war, because death itself will be destroyed. I'm going to read you some lovely verses from Revelation 21, which are the hope of the Christian. This is our hope. John has a vision of heaven and of the eternal future of the believers. And he says, Lindy, do you want to read it?
Revelation 21, verse 1. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea.
The thing I want you to focus on is God is planning a new heaven and a new earth. Brand new. It won't be like this one. The old one will pass away. The new one will be wonderful and different. A new heaven and earth. And by the way, do you notice heaven and earth, they will be together then because God, well, we'll see. I'm jumping ahead. Verse 2.
Revelation 21, verse 2. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband.
Now, some people focus on the holy city, this Jerusalem, and think there's going to be a massive new Jerusalem. But the point is here, this city is a bride. Who is the bride? It's the church. The bride, beautifully dressed for her husband, Christ. What's coming down out of heaven in Revelation is the appearance of the church of Jesus Christ, complete and whole for the first time. In the book of Revelation, when Jesus comes again, the church will be revealed for the very first time in all its completeness. All the believers of all time, of all the ages, coming down from heaven like a beautiful bride adorned for a husband, and will be united together with Christ forever. Glorious. The church, our hope is the church will be complete and will appear in glory together. Let's go on because it gets better.
Revelation 21 verse 3. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God.
Heaven and earth are going to come together. God will again live on the earth with his people. The Lord Jesus Christ will walk among us, and we will see him and we will fellowship with him. God himself will be with them. That is the glory of the hope that we have. It's a hope in a new heaven and earth. It's a hope that the church as a whole will be there. Everyone who God intends to save will be saved, and that we will be with God and he will be with us. Let's go on. It gets better.
Revelation 21 verse 4. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.
Do you realize how much there is in this statement, no more death? It means there'll be no more wars, because wars lead to death. It may mean there will be no more viruses, because viruses lead to death. It will be no more accidents, no more troubles, and no more anything that would lead to death. They won't just happen anymore. It just will not happen. We will never die. That is our hope, is that one day there will be an end, not just to one war, but to all wars. One day there won't just be an end to this coronavirus, but there will be an end to all viruses. Do you know that, believer? Is that the hope in your hearts? Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, he says, if we have hope only in this world, we are most pitied, because this world, all our hopes get dashed eventually. Once we get here, all our hopes will be realized, and no one will ever be able to take them away again, because they are eternal. Number 5. Verse 5.
Yeah, not sure why that didn't.
Is it not going on?
Yeah, I moved it on. Oh, there we go. Revelation 21, verse 5. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.
Just to remind us, everything, the new heaven and earth, but everything's going to be new. None of the old stuff, none of the stuff that wears out, none of the stuff that perishes, none of the stuff that fades. As the scripture says, it's all new. That's what heaven's going to be like. Verse 6.
Revelation 21, verse 6. He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life."
I emphasize these words because "it is done," that links back to the cross. When Christ said on the cross, "It is finished, it is done," that's the same thing here. It's almost like he's saying, "It's done, it's happened, it's completed. We've just got to get to it. It's already assured." And again, there's this offer here. "To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Have you been looking for the fount of eternal youth? Here it is. It's Jesus. You go to God and say, 'Please, I want to live forever.' And he will show you Jesus, and he will bring Jesus into your life, and you will live eternally. It's done. Christ achieved it on the cross. We accept it." Final verse.
Revelation 21, verse 7. "Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children."
Are you trusting in the Lord? Are you living the victorious Christian life? Are you letting the Lord into your life, letting him work out his life in you? We're going to inherit all of this that we've been talking about. It's there for us. We're looking forward to it. In the meantime, we put our trust in God and we live as his children in this world, cared for in these difficult days where some of the effects of sin are still felt by us on a daily basis, but looking forward to a day when we will come into the fulfillment of all that Jesus achieved on the cross. He conquered sin to give us peace. He conquered death to give us life. He conquered hell to give us eternal hope. Hallelujah. Good. Anna sang a wonderful song recently in her Thought for the Day, which some of you might not have got hold of, and it talks about these final celebrations and our final hope, and we're going to look at that one. You can sing along if you know it with her, or you can just listen to it as Anna sings it. I'm not going to sing so that you can hear her voice doing the lead. Sorry about the pause, but...
There is a day that's all created.
Let's pray, shall we? Father, we thank you that along with the rest of this country, we are celebrating 75 years since VE Day. We thank you for bringing us the victory that brought peace, an end to conflict, an end to turmoil. We thank you for preserving this country's freedom and peace and the known world, which would have perhaps been overrun. We thank you, Father, for preserving life, that the end of the conflict brought an end to killing. And so life was preserved. And we thank you for the peace and life that we have celebrated for 75 years now in this country. And we know there are still many wars in this world, sadly. And fighting and conflict, we long for the day to come when there is peace, will reign forever. Father, we thank you too that that has given hope to this country. We've been able to look forward and plan and build as a country over these 75 years in the peacetime that has reigned. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for all of those who work to preserve that peace, for all of those in the armed forces still who work to maintain that peace in this land. Bless them in their work. bless those who still put their lives at risk, not just for us, but in other places in the world. We thank you too that as believers we can celebrate too the peace we have with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. Or help us to grasp how wonderful it is to know rightness with God and to be reconciled to him. Thank you for eternal life that we begin living now but will come into its full fulfillment when Christ comes again. We thank you for the hope that we have, that we don't just trust God for this life, but we're trusting God for beyond the grave, when we shall rise and be with him forever, as that song says. May you encourage our hearts, and anyone who's listening who doesn't yet truly know the Lord Jesus Christ and have a real confidence of faith in him and peace with God and life with God and hope with God, I pray that you'd open their hearts now to accept him and receive what is freely offered to them. And we pray for the coronavirus, Father. Here is an enemy that is still not been dealt with. And Lord, we know that so many in this world are not living in peace. They are troubled in their hearts and minds, in our own country, frightened in their homes sometimes, frightened of getting it, frightened that family might get it. Father, troubled about how this might impact their work and their livelihood and their long-term situation. God, we pray that you'd bring peace by conquering this virus. We pray that you'd bring life by helping those who are in the medical profession to preserve life, but also by helping those who are developing a vaccine to come up with one quickly, soon, one that can be quickly then spread through the population and bring an end to the spread of this virus. Please, we pray. And then it will restore hope. God, we pray, deal with this virus and restore hope. We thank you that there is hope. There is a confidence that you will work and that you will bless those who are working on the ground, and that through it you'll bring us to victory. We commit ourselves to you in Jesus' precious name, Lord, for this matter, for our lives, and for all that we do day by day. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I just would love to finish with another song that celebrates victory. And it's a lovely Kendrick one. There's a sound on the wind like a victory song. It's also looking to that eternal hope we have.
Come on, heaven's children, the city is
some from the Jersey and through the gates of the sky. And we shall bow down to his beautiful name. We shall rise with a shout, we shall fly.
To reference that very last line to the fact that we'll meet him in the air. Praise God. I hope God has blessed you this morning. We're going to say a grace now that just covers some of the things we've mentioned this morning. Let's say the grace together. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. God bless you. We'll see you later on. If you're able to join us at 7 o'clock, remember, we're hoping to take communion together. God be with you all.